the very first draft was completely different from what we know it to be. I'm like, what are y'all doing? Like, this isn't, that character never existed. Like, this dude's black, not Latino. Like, it was, I had so many questions about the process.
For those who don't know, Spencer, his life inspired the television show All American. And I guess to further, it's funny how you kept being in my world without me ever having met you. So I get my hair braided in Inglewood. And because this is a long process, typically my braider she is an unofficial TV critic. She watches everything. So I went in there one day and she was like, got to get you on this new show. I was like, all right, All American. My husband watches it. Like, he's a big fan. He was on it before I was. He had told me to do it. Mm-hmm. But I have 6 hours to kill in the braiding shop. So I'm just like, let's go through All American. Yeah. This is perfect. We watched a season. We watched almost all of the first season, for sure. And then I finished the rest at home. And it's a really great show. And I'm sure you probably hear this all the time, that people probably call it, like, underrated or undiscovered. However, you know, those secret, right? Like that. What if so far, like, how do you felt about the reaction to the show? Because everybody I know who's in on the show, I know no one who doesn't like it and doesn't get it. Like, everybody who I know watches the show really, really messes with it. So how have you felt about the reaction?
Man, it's been insane. From our first season, you know, being the little show that could on CW, when every other show on CW was like supernatural, superhuman, superhero or whatnot. And then you just had this show about a black kid in South Central, like, dealing with, you know, his woes. But once people saw it on Netflix that first season, and this was while we were building out season two, realizing, like, yo, we're not just this little show anymore. Like, we're starting conversations, we're having people talk across the lines to each other, you know, just opening up that dialogue. I think from the jump, that's what we wanted from day one, which is to have conversations. You know, I have like 10-year-old black girls and like 60-year-old white men hitting me up in my DMs for the same reason as why they like the show. So at the end of the day, I love it, and I'm just excited to dive into season three.
Because this is a story that is based loosely off your real life, and I think it's important that people know, you know, that it's loosely, because I don't want to give too much of it away, but there are some dramatic things that happened that did not happen to you. Like, you didn't get shot. Okay, I'll give away one spoiler. Like, you didn't get shot, right?
But you're not. I'm joking.
I read that you have not been shot, okay? But that being said, though, because you lived your own life, you know what Hollywood does. Were you reluctant to allow them to add these dramatic bits that didn't actually happen to you?
That was by far my biggest learning experience in this profession. You know, from the timeline to even when everything started to happen, was like, we knew we were getting a pilot ordered going into my last game of the season. So when I got cut before that last game, I retired. Like, I'm gonna just try to make headway into All American, what we knew All American to be. But when we were writing the pilot out, you know, the first draft that I saw was completely different than all the stories I told them. And that was a long process in itself, just diving back into my past, like, understanding what was really fucked up and what, you know, oh, this happened to me. I'm thinking about it now. Like, that shouldn't have happened to me the way it happened. Like, it was very, like, therapeutic for me to go back in time and rethink of these moments. But when I'm telling them to the writer's room and our showrunner and whatnot, and then they come back with a story, the very first draft was completely different from what we know it to be. I'm like, what are y'all doing? Like, this isn't, that character never existed. Like, this dude's black, not Latino. Like, it was, I had so many questions about the process. And that's when they sat me down. I was like, listen, the fact that it's inspired by, like, you have to allow for creative freedom to make, just to make a show that could, you know, span across, you know, many demographics. So, you know, when we were, after I got that lesson, I was like, all right, I'm still mad, but, like, let me see where this goes. And I felt like, for the most part, they stay true to a lot of the bones of my memories and my stories that I told them. But at the end of the day, it's just to make a compelling show.
Okay, well, let's go back a little bit. So you played 7 years in the NFL. Mm-hmm. At what point did you really... and you did it under the intention of, like, you wanted to retire. I've read this, and you can certainly clear it up if it's not true. You wanted to retire by the time you were 30. Is that correct?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. That was my goal. And it, obviously looking back now, it seemed kind of crazy that like this undrafted guy was like, I'm going to play 7-8 years and then retire. Cause I just, you didn't know if you could even get to that level of playing 7-8 years, but I had a really good mentor. I would call him my first mentor. His name is James Harris. He was at the University of Oregon with me. But he just saw something in me and said, hey, you're an econ major, like you're doing things in the community. Like I want to plug you into the community in terms of business. So, you know, my last two or three years at Oregon, you know, I was doing the books for a bar. I'm talking coming in before practice and like, you know, literally doing their bank bags, doing their finances and stuff, and then going to practice. So I just carried that into the league to the point where I said, okay, I'm gonna commit my 20s to playing football as long as I can. But once I get to 30, that's where like business comes out. That's when like the other side of me comes out. And, you know, every off season I would do a new internship or a job shadowing experience, or, you know, those Monday nights when the teams have dinners or fundraisers, whatever, I'm getting business cards and everything. But yeah, when I got to like 26, 27, I started to think like there's more to life than just hitting people. And I don't know if my coaches felt that from me, but I think that's when I leaned into my hobby at the time, which was writing. You know, I always thought I would be, you know, econ major. So it's like, I was, you know, the big suit, the tie, Wall Street, whatever. But I just had this little hobby on the side that like took my mind away from everything, which was writing. And it wasn't until probably my last year to where I realized like, all right, I'm done with this. I'm not even gonna try to say, maybe I can go to 31, maybe I can go to 32. Like at 29, I said, I'm done with it.
So when did the thought bubble happen that you decided that your life was something that should be a television show?
Well, it happened during a bye week in 2016, towards the end of the year in 2016. I had been writing just casually for like 2 years at this point, short stories. Just literally things that like happened in my life that I thought might be funny or might be interesting or ideas popped in my head and whatnot. And one of my good friends, Skylar Ort, hit me up and said, hey, I know you're writing, like my roommate sells in the unscripted space. And, you know, next time you're back in LA, why don't we all get together, you know, have a beer and just talk, maybe something will come from this. So that bye week, I stopped over at their apartment and it was, you know, we were probably watching a game or something like a Thursday night game or whatever. And my now producing partner, closest friend, Dane Mork, he went to Palos Verdes High School, which is like 20, 30 minutes away from Beverly, but it's a completely different world. Like Palos Verdes is like the West Virginia of the West Coast. Like you don't know what happens. They just govern themselves up there.
Like, I'm like, damn, that's a hell of a description.
And it's a description that came from him. Like they are Texas football. They are like West Virginia mountain mysterious. Like they don't come down the hill. We don't go up there essentially. But we just started talking about, you know, what was it like growing up in Beverly Hills? And that's when I corrected him, like, oh no, I grew up in South Central, but I just went to Beverly Hills. Oh, how was that? Well, you know, I'd wake up at, you know, 4:45, 5 o'clock in the morning, get my little brother ready, drop him off at my grandmother's house, then trek it across town to go to school. And he's like, bro, I'd wake up at 7:50 and get to school with 5 minutes to spare. Like it was just a completely different world. So I thought nothing of it, honestly. It was just a cool conversation with somebody else that like we kind of knew of each other's schools and played against each other when we were younger. But a few weeks later, he hit me up and said, hey, a show he's working on is kind of dead in the water, but he had a conversation about my story with a producer named Robbie Rogers. And that's when he said, like, hey, do you mind writing up like a one-page document as to like what you went through? Like, if it was a story, what would you write to be your story? And that's when I wrote up this like literally one page, two paragraph document, sent it off. And then 3 weeks later, I'm getting a call from like a head of Warner Brothers, like, hey, let's have a meeting.
So just to further prove how small the world is, Robbie's in my yoga, we go to the same yoga studio.
Oh, there we go.
he's amazingly bendy. Yeah. Like he puts me to shame every
time. That's some soccer players, man.
Yeah. Soccer players. Every time we do a class together, I am amazed by his nimbleness and my lack thereof. So you go from this idea that then turns into a show. You know, and just for people who have, or even if you haven't watched All American, is that, as you put, the crux of it is true. It's like it is about a kid who's living in two different worlds, and you know, trying to make the football thing happen. Some of the more the gang elements and stuff like that. The, yeah. So it was a little bit, you know, Hollywood eyes, you know, if you will. And then, of course, the lack of relationship with father and their, with his father, although there's a big kind of spoil that happens there that I'm not going to give away for the mm-hmm. people that haven't seen it. That part was not necessarily, obviously, your life. But just going through this, you know, process where you're seeing yourself on screen, is it, it's a business for you. So is it hard for you to stay, you know, emotionally unattached, or are you still like really attached to the material? Cause it is essentially about you.
Yeah, I would say yes and no. You know, early on I had to come to the reality that Spencer James is not Spencer Paysinger. And you know, those first couple episodes, you know, they're calling Spencer on set and I'm messing up shots because I'm like, huh? Like literally in the background looking at the camera.
And you also have a role in the show too.
Yeah. So yeah. A lot of people are finding that out. It's like, I've been in the background of all the football scenes from episode one, just sort of an Easter egg. But yeah, I had to make that distinction that Spencer James was just, he just wasn't Spencer Paysinger. Even to the point when, you know, talking to Daniel and him asking me like, hey, what would you want me to portray? It was like, nah, make Spencer James you. Like, don't feel like you need to follow me or talk like me or whatever. You know, just bring the best version of Spencer James you think is going to convey on screen. But, you know, at the end of the day, like, sometimes I do have to protect my family from the story because, you know, some things that happened with my mom and dad, you know, they happened, but it was a different way. Or maybe we're painting my mom in a different light and my dad in another light. So those are always like the scary conversations. And I'm like, damn, mom. So like in like two episodes, some shit's going to happen. And like, I didn't write it, but like, I couldn't say no. So, you know, they love it. I love that I can have those conversations to them. You know, even me and my dad have had a handful of conversations in that aspect where he's like, whenever my dad says, say dude, that's when you know he was mad about something, but he had time to think about it. And his say do was like his peace offer, like, all right, now I can talk about it. But yeah, it's making that distinction that like Spencer James is not me, but also I do have to like sort of protect my family from stories because I know they're going to get 1,000 questions from their friends about what's real and what's not. So I'm just giving them a little caution before.